was hoping that I would be out having fun or just anything. I mean, I used to cheer, and I couldn't this year because I'm pregnant.
It was just for a pure basic pleasure. Sorry, I know somebody's mad. I'm 14 years old, she's 17.
He's got his days with his mic confused right now.
I didn't sleep with a lot of people.
I told my mom I was going shopping.
This one isn't that.
Crystal, Miranda, Marcy, Leah, Brian, and Tara talked with us about the complications of making babies.
I was involved with this guy for a long time, and he went to college. I think when he went to college, it was really hard to let go.
I met someone when I was abroad that I felt like I was alone with.
I think I felt abandoned, sort of. Maybe I was alone. This person who I did have sex with could give me what he took with him. And at the time, we were just kissing or whatever, and it just went to having sex.
I was feeling very much courted and very much maybe adored, even. And that was exciting.
I got my apartment, my own apartment with my other two roommates. That's where I met my son's father. We came together and then we were born like the fire comes in.
When I came home from that semester abroad, I discovered that I was pregnant.
I mean, morally, I didn't believe that I wasn't right until you got married. So I was surprised at myself.
I just felt it in my heart that what I did was dirty. I went home and regretted it.
He found out I was pregnant.
I was happy at the time not to have to deal with the parents and that disappointment and that. I mean, I've lived it out already in a lot of ways, and it's just, I can't think of much. I can't think of anything that feels worse.
I don't know if I feel bad about my dad. I mean, it's just like, almost immune to it or something, but he's not. It's out of sync with him because he doesn't speak to me, so I don't look at him. With my mom right now and my little brother and the house.
I just thought that my dad would yell at me because father's always like that.
The hardest thing was not having anyone there with me. I really didn't know who to ask.
It seems to me that my father was really understanding. Reached out and hugged me. My mom was the one who had a really hard time.
Maybe the second hardest thing was going home and pretending like I really hadn't been out shopping all day.
On one Sunday morning, I went up in front of the youth group and I just said I was pregnant, and just the reaction from everyone was so great afterwards. Everyone came up to me after I spoke and just said, "You're so brave. And I'm there for you. You can call me anytime." It made me feel so much better that I finally told someone that I didn't have to keep it in myself and that I can actually talk with people about this. And not with my mom.
The guys who love you forever and whatever, it's not that they don't. You're just there for one thing to them. I ended up in a situation I did.
first reaction was, it can't be mine. There's no way. I ejaculated.
Tony and I broke up. I moved back home because I couldn't stay in my apartment. Just a lot of memories where I couldn't sleep in my own bedroom because I could smell him, you know, hear his voice, and I couldn't do that.
I told him that I thought I was pregnant when I knew I was pregnant.
His mom pointed her finger at me and blamed me for all those.
He wrote back and said, well, if you're pregnant, then you tear half an abortion because that's murder, and that's wrong. You need to come to Costa Rica and marry me.
And she did not want to say anything to her son.
Chores and stuff.
So then I wrote and told him I had a miscarriage.
My boyfriend, we're still together. We've been together a year and a month.
I didn't want the weight of anyone's judgment, least of all his.
You know, he's working and I'm gonna start working. So right now everything's gonna be okay.
I've only got an 8th grade education. That's not getting me nowhere right now. I'm on welfare, so I get $280 a month, and that's nothing.
I work at 7th grade. You know, he works full time and he takes really good care of us.
And it's like new clothes, bottles, formula. And then I've got maybe $5 at the end of the month for myself.
I worked my butt off throughout the whole summer while being pregnant. It was hard. My feet ached when I got home from work because the summer was supposed to be my time.
Of the rejection I've gone through in my life, I think I would feel be crushed if I did that to somebody else.
I had a lot of people tell me what to do and what not to do, and that really made it difficult for me. I've been tugged in different directions. Some people want me to keep it, some people want me to abortion or adoption, and I just feel adoption was best. I still have a lot of things I really want to do in life, and if I had this baby and kept it, it's just my career, just everything I want to do, it just won't work out.
My mom didn't want me to have it, and I thought, well, I mean, I guess the people would say it was a mistake, but I don't really consider that it is. I mean, it's my responsibility, I'm gonna take care of it. I plan to have it and keep it at this point.
Usually after engaging in some behavior which numbs the pain, it comes back. And it's, you know, it's like, shoot, it's not gone, it's not going anywhere, and I know it.
When I leave out of the room, he starts to scream. And I just get so frustrated, I literally want to take him and just shake him, but I don't have to. I've resorted to hitting walls, slamming cabinets, sliding my head into walls, into the door. That works real well.
Alcohol helps take it away for a couple hours at least. And, you know, usually I can sleep real well if I've been drinking.
Taking them everywhere. Having to change them about 4 times a day. Just like last night, he threw up all over me.
My hormones are all out of whack. It's like being pregnant with the stomach, but it's really hard. You have a lot of
the sense of God's grace, of that depth of compassion from my spirit, nothing to feel this bad.
Yeah, I just got saved about 5.5 months ago. Tara led me pretty much because I was into a lot of stuff I shouldn't have been into. Into a lot of drugs, and I smoked, she didn't like that, did a lot of stuff, and she was too scared to lose me if she talked about God, so she just kept it in as long as she could, but she couldn't keep it in anymore, so she told me I was doubting her, I was saying a bunch of stuff.
Saying get your life back together, you gotta go up and everything. It wasn't like he punished me. It was my choice. It was my fault. It brought me closer to him, actually. I started reading the Bible and praying more.
To me, I mean, God told me, I'm like, you know, I can't do this without you. Certain things we've never really discussed in our relationship, and I think that's why a lot of things
actually, I remember being in a Bible study my senior year of high school, and the guy who was leading it said that about 75% of you who are Christians will turn your back on God when you go off to college. And at that time, just being on fire for God, I couldn't imagine ever doing that. I kind of shook my head. So that's crazy. When I got to college, what I found was I was just inundated by so many things that were trying to take my sight off of Christ. I remember walking onto campus and within the first week, going to a party on frat row, seeing a big beer truck lined up with taps out the side. Everything there said,
let's go!
Sex means sedate me. Whatever you wanted to do is fine. Basically, it was saying, let your appetites control you rather than you controlling your appetites. It turned into be a real struggle. Just compromising. It's just a slow process of not getting involved with Christian friends, not getting involved with the church when I went off to school, not making the effort to see my own spiritual life grow. I hate it when I give in to those things. The Bible study teacher told me that 75% of us would turn away. It's not so foolish anymore. Myself sitting in my dorm room on several occasions by myself, just wondering what was up, what was going on. It's a beautiful dark night of the soul, I guess. I remember just falling on my knees and saying, God, what happened? And in tears, I didn't know even how to get back to him. It was just a process of confessing back to God and saying, I don't know. I think God brought me through this journey of just wanting to serve Christ, getting involved in some ministry stuff, working with high school students, and completely redirected the course of my life. I regret that I probably wasn't aware enough and hadn't prepared myself enough for the challenges of being a Christian in that atmosphere in a university like that, and thinking back. Students, knowing that Christ was there the whole time, that Jesus wanted me to come back, is something that I always take with me. But I think probably the biggest thing that I learned from that whole thing is that Christ forgives.
Because I graduated, and 2 weeks later we were out on the road.
Most bands, it seems, work for
Silgum, who's a songwriter in the band.
I've always been fascinated with books and poetry and the workings of words and how they sound together.
He kind of opened my eyes to other styles of music.
That I was supposed to do, you know, the place where dreams would come from and that I could work my dreams off of.
Hank Williams Jr. was recording here the other day, and when I was 12 or 13, he was the end all and be all. I mean, I got to say hey to him, and he said hey back, so that's just been really cool.
Played in churches, youth groups, colleges, coffee houses, even clubs. We did some dates with 10,000 Maniacs. I got to see the wide spectrum of what people think. I'm very glad we all hooked up with Tess.
I'd heard their CD once before, because we had friends that were friends of each other, mutual friends in Austin. And so I heard the tape, I thought it was really pretty music. But it wasn't the type of music I was playing. I was playing a lot harder edge stuff. And so when he asked me to play with him, I was like, well, I'll have to think about it. And then he said, okay, because we're going on tour with someone, we're going to Europe. I was like, oh, okay, I'll do it. This month, the second record has to be great. Making them
mine. Can be drudgery at times.
Let's go for it.
Yeah. If I could collect
my playing it over and over and over for the perfect take.
You gotta do the whole line. If I was Meyer,
if I could collect. What was wrong with Meyer the first time? Was it pitch?
Yes, pitch.
The vocals have to be on pitch this time.
It definitely gets to be long, sitting around the studio waiting for your parts.
I met Matt in church, and he approached me with the song Trust, which is on the first record, and he wanted me to sing it on a demo just for our friends and family to listen to for Christmas presents.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding.
Songs, so we put those down and demo.
I like to sing, even though I don't really consider myself a singer.
She's great with coming up with harmonies, and she's got a great voice.
My dad is Fletch Wiley. He plays trumpet and flute and a lot of kinds of jazz music. Actually, I used to think he worked at the airport because we were always taking him there when I was a little girl.
My family life wasn't too great. My parents got divorced when I was about 3. As a result, I didn't know my father very well and grew up, you know, just living at home by myself with my mom. My dad passed away from a heart attack, so it was a fairly quick thing, and I hadn't seen him in a while. That kind of angered me because I didn't really get a chance to say anything to say goodbye or to say what I'd recently come, you know, to believe in.
What's been the most significant adjustment to life after high school?
Just being out of hell.
basically, it's just what it seems like, because I hated high school so much.
He puts his fist as close to my face as possible without hitting me, and then he goes for the punch.
I just really didn't care. I was involved in music way too much to care.
And then I move a little closer. He does it again. And if he knows better, he won't do it again.
I don't know if I'll ever establish myself as like a really great musician or anything. That's why I'm trying to develop my skills as a songwriter. I tend to like to spread myself then, because that way I'm not like expected. People don't expect too much in any one area.
In school, I was really, really quiet and very shy. I'd never talk and very intimidated by other people, so I didn't act out at school. But at home, I suppose I'm a pretty big show-off.
It's kind of weird because I get depressed because I feel like I'll never, like, really amount to much musically. But then you think about it, it's like it's kind of selfish that I'm still doing it if I don't think I'm any good. But
as we were catapulted into teenage stardom, I just progressively kept feeling better about myself and stuff, which was good, and I wasn't getting too prideful about it, or prideful at all. It just gave me a good sense of when I was doing something worthwhile and I was helping people.
I'm feeling that even if I were really good, I probably would shrug it off, or I probably wouldn't. Which in a way can be good, because, you know, you just always push hard. But at this point in my life, I'm just kind of like sitting back and thinking, there's no point in pushing, because I'll probably never get there. Which is like that whole self-pity, which is annoying and childish.
If I were to talk to somebody before the show who didn't know who I was, you know, who I was, but not that I'm anybody, but then I kind of, it's harder for me to talk to them. But then I think to myself, well, wait till after the show, you know, then they'll really know how to, you know, talk to me. And then, not that I'd be better than them then, but then at least I would be, you know, someone that they could think had some worth in them. And I think that came from, in high school, I didn't ever feel like anybody knew who I was because I would never talk. And so it just gives me confidence enough to talk like a normal human being.
And I have a language translator who can try to talk if you want.
I didn't know my father very well. I did try to actually bring up Christ, but I was very intimidated and didn't argue my point, and because I thought there'd be time. Everyone assumes there's more time, that everyone will be around always, and it's just not the case.
This band to be with, because I almost completely identify with Matt.
Most of the time when I'm inspired to write lyrics, it's more out of a darkened state, a depressed state.
School, because she didn't. When she was my age, she got married really young. So now I have to do something with this to make up for that.
We played a show somewhere once or twice, and the people were very adamant about constantly asking us if we were gonna do an altar call thing at the end, or if we were gonna talk for 5 or 6 minutes about God.
Disconnect myself from me.
I did feel like after we told them that we're just not being called to do that right now, we're just here to play the music and that's it. But it made me feel like crap, and it really made me feel
like, well, what am I doing then? This isn't worth anything. If me singing and this music isn't doing anything, then what are we doing?
God's showing me who I am. I don't really, it's funny because I don't really view it like that. I just view it like I'm realizing, but when you think about it, I guess it is God showing it to me, because if it were just me, I wouldn't want to see this about me.
That very show that the people were acting kind of rude about us not preaching or whatever, a girl came up afterwards and I went outside and I was singing this song. I was kind of crying and I was walking out to the van to get something. And on my way back in, before I was able to open the door, there was a girl there that was standing out and she was waiting for me. She said, I'm not a Christian and this music has really blessed me. And my boyfriend brought me to the show and I just didn't know what to say. I was, you know, okay, that's great. And I hugged her and I went inside and then we did the rest of our set. And then I went and got her after the show and took her outside and I told her, you know, this is how real God is. I was just out here, you know, praying him for him to show me, you know, what to do, because I really didn't feel like that what we were doing is worth anything.
My life feels like such slow motion, but when I think about what happened this last year, I've, like, done so much.
I just don't want to see myself in 20 years just being an idiot.
From a quote in Mere Christianity, talking about how a child goes to his father and asks him for sixpence to buy him a present. And the kid goes and buys a present for the father, and the father likes it very much. But you'd be, you know, a fool to say that the father's any better off, because he gave the child the money in the first place to buy the gift.
I'm also experimenting with, like, having hope, learning to, like, respect what I do.
I just want to stay real and know where my place is.
I guess we've taken, or trying to take that attitude towards God, that to be very humble in his presence and to understand that we don't deserve anything from him, and are trying to offer, you know, the abilities that he's given us back to him. We'll be right back.
you, Liam? Doesn't Chip pick the restaurant on his birthday?
Chip picks the restaurant on everybody's birthday.
And that's okay with you?
Well, no, it's not okay, but it's a stupid restaurant. It's fine.
Why am I not convinced? So you'll have someone to talk to. More importantly, why is Chip here?
Don't get me started on Chip.
Too late. Didn't he move out? To work.
He doesn't even leave the house until after dark.
But then he doesn't come home until dawn.
I
would
know.
Wouldn't you?
Who are you? Hey, you guys, are we going? I decided I want pizza.
Fine by me.
That's just fine, lady.
Oh, did you measure with Daddy? See the lady hunt.
Chip, are you sure it's fine with you? It's your birthday. It's fine, Mama. Can we just go?
Fine. I only wanted to make sure it was fine with you.
It's fine. Can't we just go?
Get down here, we're waiting for you.
Hey, you were here to hear a step away from me.
Thank you.